Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Gripped by Drought, written by Arthur W. Upfield and read by John Derum. To my friend E. V. White, to whom I am indebted for the pastoral statistics and other data which have made this story possible. Author's Preface. There is no greater restraint in drama than a 3 years' drought. And such a drought, associated with drought in the human heart, is the theme of this plain tale for plain people. The course of this fictitious drought is based on the course of a real drought. I have followed the weather records over an actual 3 year drought period, and no city critic can say that such a drought is impossible. Similarly, I have followed actual wool prices over the same period. And finally, the succession of mental phases which the new chum in the bush proper must live through or else desert to a city is real and based on personal experience. I should like to add that my original title for this work was the one all-sufficient word, drought. It was found, however, that already a novel under this title was in circulation, so that, regretfully, the present more sensational title was substituted. Calamunda, W.A. The First Year. Chapter 1, Diamond Days. 1. That morning of early June, when Feng Qingwei rode a spirited dapple-grey mare beside the River Darling in western New South Wales, found his mind busied with a problem that time was beginning to describe as a sin of omission. Following considered judgment, he had, 6 months before, refused to take 21 shillings a head for 9,000 wether sheep, because the price offered had been half a crown below his own valuation. The morrow would witness the arrival of the prince, whose steward he was, and in rendering account of his stewardship, he might give just reason for dissatisfaction, not for failing to increase the talents lent him, namely sheep, but for not having decreased them. The number of sheep on the great Atlas sheep run that morning really should have been less by 9,000. A superb day, that 10th of June, a calm, sparkling, intoxicating day, to be found only in the hinterland of Australia during the midwinter months, a diamond day, for the Asia sky was reflected by the pools of water lying in the clay pans. The golden sunlight was reflected by the myriad leaves of the giant gum trees bordering the river in a stately avenue 1,000 miles long. And the very atmosphere was a brilliant crystal that magnified and brought near the western line of red, whale-backed sand dunes. The horse was walking on her toes, her neck arched, her nostrils patches of vivid crimson, her foam-flecked mouth working ever at the restraining bit. Horse and man were passing over a bar of red sand which, crossing the grey river flats from the distant pinelands, stabbed at the river's flank. Tiny shoots of grass gave to certain of its slopes, in alignment with the eye, a faint tinge of emerald. 3 days previously, it had rained. No more than the horse had the rider lived in China. Born 31 years before on the gold diggings of Tibberborough, in the northwest of the state, of his parents Feng Qingwei remembered nothing. He had been adopted by old man Mayne, the creator of Atlas, from the wilderness, who had begun to despair of ever having a son of his own. However, when Feng was 4, Frank Mayne was born, and the two boys, reared in the same nursery, later attended the same schools and were articled to the same squatter. When old man Mayne died in the first year of the peace, both boys returned to Atlas, where Feng was content to remain firm friend and shrewd financial adviser to the young master who had become sole owner of nearly 70,000 sheep and a government leasehold of over 750,000 acres. The fight old man Mayne had fought to leave his son an inheritance was one of grim, almost savage tenacity, governed by the motto, "What I have, I hold." After the 3 years' drought at the beginning of the century, he had consolidated the financial foundations of Atlas. The 1913-14 drought had failed to weaken those foundations, although the flocks were atrociously depleted. When Frank Mayne succeeded to his inheritance, he faced the booming post-year wars, and a succession of gratifyingly large annual wool checks had sent him on a 3 years world tour, leaving Feng Qing Wei sole arbiter of the destinies of Atlas. And on the morrow, Frank Mayne was returning to Atlas, bringing with him an English wife and an 11-month-old baby boy. Whilst Feng rode homeward, following the track winding among the wide-spaced box trees growing on the river flats, he recalled the moments when he had sat in the Atlas office with Frank Mayne's letter before him. The words, the quickly written, impulsive words, lay beneath his hands, which trembled. "Ere you get this, old man, I shall be married." Married! Frank in England and married! And 20 miles south of Atlas, Anne Shelley. They three, Anne Shelley, Frank Mayne, and Feng Qing Wei, were of the same class and generation. They had grown up together, even school days failing to come between them. Whilst there never had been a declaration of love between Anne and Frank before he went away, young Mayne had hinted that after he had had his fling, he would propose marriage to Anne. With the arrogance of youth, he had said it, and Feng then had no doubt that Frank would propose and that Anne would accept him. But Frank married suddenly in England, and he never suspected the hurt he thereby rendered Anne Shelley, the hurt that rebounded from her, to his lifelong friend, Feng Qing Wei. 2. With the fates of Anne Shelley and Frank Mayne burdening his mind, Feng Qing Wei did not at once see the sun-reflecting car which emerged from a belt of mallee, speeding towards him at an outrageous pace. It was some seconds after the mare first became excited that the increasing hum of the engine penetrated his curtain of daydreaming. Then, looking up and recognizing the low-hung body of the Tintin car, he reined off the track and dismounted. The car slowed to a stop, a gloved hand was waved to him, the blue silk scarf floating out over the rear of the single-seater beckoned him. With quickened heartbeats, he led the horse close to the machine, behind the steering wheel of which sat the mistress of Tintin Station, Miss Anne Shelley. "Feng, I have been hoping to meet you," she exclaimed gaily, her grey eyes alight, her face flushed by the quick rush through the air. "Meeting you makes a lovely day perfect," Feng murmured. "It makes me feel very young, meeting you," was her parry. "You know, Feng, even though we growed up together, and you are 4 years older than I, you make me always feel, well, juvenile. Your face is without a line, your black eyes regarding me so benevolently are inscrutable. I have never been able to read your thoughts. No wonder you play poker so well. Would you be glad or sorry to step down from the seat of Atlas tomorrow?" "I shall not regret abdicating, Anne," he said, with slow, perfect articulation. "I have done my best to govern Atlas, yet would I rather occupy the position of Grand Vizier, because in that sphere responsibility is less, and I can fill my mind with matters other than sheep and money, fodders and rain." "Your pictures?" "Exactly. My pictures. Whilst I paint, I am a god. At all other times, I am a worm. For 3 years, I have seldom been a god." He was smiling at her with his old trick of quizzical penetration. His semi-veiled eyes gleamed with the warmth of friendship. He was master absolute of himself. "You will want now to have me sit a few more times to finish my portrait. Well, things at Atlas will be different, won't they?" Search though she did, she failed to observe any change in his expression. "That is undoubted, Anne. Even so, Mrs. Mayne surely will be as pleased as I shall for you to visit Atlas often. I was hoping that when Frank was again firmly established on the seat of Atlas, you would give me a few more sittings. You see, the portrait that has been occupying both our times and our interest was not satisfactory, almost finished though it was, and you know what I do to a canvas with which I am not satisfied."
"You did not destroy it."
He inclined his head. She accepted the inclination as his reluctant assent. She did not see his eyes.
"Feng, you are wicked," she chided him, genuine regret in her musical voice. "It promised to be your best picture, and now I'm afraid I shall not be able to come to Atlas very often."
Looking up, the swords of their gaze met. What he saw in her eyes hurt him. He said, "I believe I understand. The mountain shall go to Mahomet." "You are one of the understanding kind, old boy. It's 3 years since he went away, but time has been a poor doctor. The rain came just in time, didn't it? Did I not say that the dry spell would not last?"
"You did," he assented, again smiling.
"You predicted rain to me on the telephone, having observed a bunch of steers racing about with tails elevated. If the frosts hold off, we should show a good picking of grass by shearing time. Another good rain next month and a further fall in August will assure us of summer feed. How many do you expect to shear this year?"
"Somewhere about 30,000, I suppose. My lambs have done well, in spite of the dry spell. Well, I must go, Feng. Everything ready at Atlas?"
"Everything, thanks to your assistance. I should have been hopelessly at sea had you not come to my rescue with the decorations and the furniture."
"I did it to help you," she said softly, adding with a touch of colour in her cheeks, "and Frank. But you'll say never a word about it, will you? It was my real present to him."
Unconsciously falling into the imagery of his race, he said, "If the greatest souled man climbed to the top of a mountain peak 100 miles high, he would see, standing on a peak he could never hope to reach, a woman."
"She would be very cold, Feng," Anne said with smiling lips, but with misty eyes. "Au revoir."
The engine hummed. Feng Qingwei stepped back, hat in hand. He was smiling calmly when the girl let out the clutch pedal. "Au revoir, Anne." She waved to him and was gone. 3. Continuing his meditations, Feng walked on homeward, the mare docilely following. Australian-born, reared in the omnipresent bush among Australia's bluest-blooded squatocracy, educated in Australia's best schools, there was nothing in his gait or his physical appearance to betray his ancestry. Weighed in European scales, he was by no means ill-looking, descended as he was from stock much above the coolie class. As a man, he was a credit to old man Mayne's judgment of human pedigree, which was as sound as it notably had been in the case of cattle, horses, and sheep. His gabardine, slack-encased legs were straight, his body lean and supple, his hands as well-formed as those of any polished aristocrat. The track presently led him to the riverbank at one of its sharp bends. That morning the stream was low, trickling from deep hole to deep hole, the inevitable hole washed out at every sharp elbow. The water was brown, but yesterday it had been as clear as crystal. The rain had sent down a freshet. The woman fishing with a handline failed to hear the approach of man and horse. She was seated ungracefully at the rocky edge of a large, deep hole, and observing her, Feng halted, so unusual was it, to meet with a female sundowner. For that she was a sundowner, i.e. tramp, was evident. On the branch of a fallen tree, partly buried in the bank, was laid a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.